which is also supported by other study done by Seth Sheila Devi, where the refractive rate were higher in urban areas compared to rural areas. And also the girls were higher in found to be higher in refractive error. In my study, most common refractive error found to be myopia followed by astigmatism and hypermetropia. Okay, sir. Which was supported by other two studies done by Shai Dushya and other study done by Nitish Prandhan. Conclusion, in studying the prevalence of refractive error in our study is 6.15% among school children. Most common refractive error found to be myopia, followed by astigmatism and hypermetropia. The prevalence of refractive error is more in urban school children, which is 11.89%, compared to the rural children, which is 3.54%. And refractive error were more common in female children when compared to the male children. School health screening by ophthalmic assistant and refractionist found to be very effective in identifying refractive errors among school children. These are all my references. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Claudia, you can stop sharing your screen. Now I request the judges to ask the questions to our professor, Dr. MVS Prakash.
Yeah. Doctor, the type of refraction which was performed, was every child subjected to cyclopneutic refraction, or you've done only an auto refractometry?
So, what type of children is with the refractive error 6x9, we underwent the cyclopneutic refraction, sir.
No. My idea of asking this is whether you have ruled out pseudomyopia.
So, by diffuse light examination, we did, sir.
Okay, because that should not be included. Otherwise, the myopia, number of myopia may be, it may be looking at a larger thing. And another thing you said, the number of female children screened in this study was more, isn't it? So, can you mention what percentage among the female students showed refractive errors? From the overall total, you have told the percentage.
Yes, sir.
Have you worked out on that, or it is only a percentage of the grand total?
The percentage only, sir.
Oh, fine.
Thanks.
Right. Okay. Over to Dr. Chandru.
Yes, I've got only one question. Why did you choose the 11 to 17 year age group?
Sir, in our state, government state, they are screening from 5th to 12th standard. So it is very easy for me to done my study, sir. That's why I choose.
So you just collected the data. What is the incidence of amblyopia? What is the incidence of amblyopia in the refractive error patients? Is there any data? Because you are going to start from 5th, 6th standard. High myopia and high refractive errors would have set in with amblyopia. Did you find out anything about that?
I have found few children with amblyopia, sir, but I didn't mention in the study, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Shruti?
Dr. Kalavati, that was a good presentation. I want to ask you, you gave the conclusion that the screening by ophthalmic assistants is a good method. How did you arrive at that conclusion? Because you, in your study, you have not done comparison, right, between different methods of screening.
Ma'am, we also went that time, ma'am, when ophthalmologist
You got my point. Now, usually the conclusion should be something that we have studied and you conclude that. But here you have told, but you have not done different methods of screening. Like, I think they were all screened by ophthalmic assistants, PGs. So how can you say that it is effective? So, like, yeah, you cannot exactly say, right? I mean, it's a general thing, but there is nothing to substantiate that point in your study, right?
Okay.
And one more thing, what is the strength of your study according to you? What's the biggest strength of your study?
10,170.
Yeah, that's, I think, yeah, you got a large sample size.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. If there are no more questions, we'll go on to the next presenter. I invite Dr. Kavya. I will also request Dr. Praveena to be ready with the presentation as the next presenter. Dr. Kavya, you could go ahead with the presentation. Please share your screen. Dr. Kavya, you're ready?
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone. Today, I'm going to present on the use of topical mast stabilizers in treating allergic eye diseases. Introduction, allergic conjunctivitis occurs as an ocular manifestation of IgE immune response to allergen exposure in sensitized individuals and is characterized by itching, hyperemia, excessive tearing, conjunctival and eyelid swelling. Then there is on repeated exposure, the IgE antibodies bind to the prime the conjunctival mast cells. IgE cross-linking occurs, which triggers the mast cell degranulation and preformed mediators are formed with release of histamine, prostaglandins, cytokines, etc., which causes ocular signs and symptoms. Aim of the study is to study the effects of drugs like alcapridin, bepostidin, and olaparidin in treating allergic conjunctivitis, compare the adverse effects profile. Designed prospective hospital-based study undertaken over a period of 6 months with a sample size of 75. Newly diagnosed patients of mild to moderate allergic conjunctivitis were taken. Exclusion criteria includes allergic active ocular infection, known case of allergies, patients planned for eye surgeries, patients dry eye patients, chronic conjunctivitis already on treatment, contact lens wearers, patients on tropical treatment for other ocular pathologies, ocular surgery poster patients, and patients on systemic medication for chronic illnesses. Materials and methods is a comparative study which have 75 patients studied over a period of 6 months based on the symptomatic response, papillary reactions, adverse effect profile. They are divided into three groups based on group 1, group 2, group 3. Group 1, olaparidin BD was prescribed. Group 2, bepostidin BD. And group 3, alcapridin was prescribed. The analysis was done with the chi-square test. The examination include relevant ocular history, sit-lamp examination, and adverse effects reporting. Follow-up was done for a period of a week, 14 days, and then a month. The results are extrapolated as follows. The age distribution, about 40% of the patients with moderate conjunctivitis were in the age group of 30 and 50 years, as seen in the results. The redness relief profile was seen to be well tolerated, and alcapridin shows superior properties. In case of itching relief profile, almost all the groups showed similar profile. Watering relief was seen. Alcapridin showed superior properties in watering relief in these patients compared to the other groups. Papillary reaction relief also was seen to be superior in case of alcapridin group. And burning sensation is a mild adverse effect seen with topical instillation of alcapridin is predominantly found to be having a burning sensation compared to bepostidin and olaparidin. The results are given. Conclusion, the efficacy...
1 minute more.
The efficacy of anti-allergic medication to reduce the symptoms is evaluated. All the topical medications were found to be well-tolerated. They are safe to use and have similar profiles of symptom relief in terms of redness, itching, and watering. While alcapridin showed superior properties in faster symptomatic relief, there was a transient burning sensation associated with its usage. But it was found to be very less compared to the other drugs. Thank you.
Yeah. Can I ask you? Dr. Kavya, did you use any scoring sheet for grading the symptom relief? Did you have any standard scoring sheet, say grade 1?
I had grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, based on the severity of the complaints at presentation and at each visit, sir. Accordingly, what the patient gave the history, we had recorded accordingly, sir. Like grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, mild, moderate, and severe redness, hyperemia, and papillary reactions, which was found by sit-lamp examination, sir.
And I believe it was a truly blinded study that the investigator, it was only a blinded study?
It was supposed to be, it was a blinded study, sir.
How did you make sure of that? How did you perform practically?
Sir, I had given them the drops
you have administered the drop. So who was evaluating?
Yes, sir.
No, you have administered the eye drops. So who was evaluating the the response?
Yes, sir. Myself, I evaluated the response based on what the patient gave the history, sir. I had advised them to give me the history when they found that they had a proper relief with the instillation of drugs, on which day they had a very good relief on constant use, sir. And according to that, I elicited the history, sir.
Now, what I mean is, you were the only investigator. You didn't seek the help of another investigator for blinding purpose, so that there will be unbiased scrutiny.
Yes, sir.
Okay, right.
Thank you.
So, over to Dr. Chandru. I think Chandru, you have
Right. You said allergic conjunctivitis. You know, it's a broad spectrum. Was it categorized as, you know, whatever spring catarrh and whatever, or is it one group of allergic conjunctivitis or any person with itching?
Sir, I had taken all the patients who were newly diagnosed with the mild or moderate type of conjunctivitis in the study, sir.
It can be anything, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, was there any difference in the, I mean, the way the drug reacted with different types? Number one, how many were resistant to any of these drugs and you had to shift to another drug or a steroid? That is what I'd like to know.
Patients responded properly, sir. Almost all the drops showed a similar profile.
You didn't show 100% response, no?
100% response, like olaparidin showed some somewhat not superior qualities to alcaptan, sir. Alcaptan had better response, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, Dr. Shruti.
Yeah. Dr. Kavya, you said allergic conjunctivitis, but one of the exclusion criteria mentioned was allergies. How was that?
Any systemic allergies, ma'am, like they had any drug allergies or allergies to any food items, all that.
Okay. You have not mentioned that. You just mentioned any allergy in the, like, you know. And allergy conjunctivitis, commonly they have associated allergies. So why did you exclude, like, it's very common, no, that for them to have associated allergic rhinitis and other things. What was the reason for excluding them, known allergy?
Those people who came to me, they had, they were already on treatment, ma'am. Those people who were having allergies to like dust allergy and all those people with allergic rhinitis, they were already on treatment, ma'am. On and off treatment. So they were chronic allergic conjunctivitis patients. So I had excluded chronic patients, ma'am, who were already on topical treatment. Only newly diagnosed patients were taken, ma'am.
So, like, criteria was itching, presence of itching, right? For taking them as allergic.
Yes, ma'am. And by slit lamp, I found papillary reactions and then classified it into mild and moderate, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, if there are no more questions, I will ask the next presenter, Dr. Praveena, to share your screen and go on with your presentation.
Good morning. My topic is an eagle's eye view on optical penetrating keratoplasty in a university teaching hospital. Penetrating keratoplasty is the gold standard for conditions that involve full thickness of the cornea. Both donor and host factors influence the visual outcome post-penetrating keratoplasty. Hospital-derived corneas are optimal because death to enucleation preservation time is a lot lesser. In a tertiary care center with a multidisciplinary ICU, adequate systems are essential for proper and early retrieval of cornea. The hospital donor corneal retrieval program aims at setting up a multidisciplinary team that comprises of eye bank technicians and eye donation counselors headed by an ophthalmologist. Aim is to study the clinical indication, visual outcome, complications of penetrating keratoplasty and the factors affecting them, like the effect of hospital versus home corneal button retrieval and death to enucleation preservation time. This is a prospective study conducted in a university teaching hospital with an established eye bank facility done over a period of 2 years. A total of 52 patients who underwent penetrating keratoplasty were included in the study. Data pertaining to the indications for keratoplasty, evaluation of cornea prior to surgery, visual acuity preoperatively and postoperatively, early and late complication of surgery was also noted. We also compared the effect of death through enucleation preservation time and the mode of retrieval to the final visual acuity of the patient post-surgery. The commonest indication for keratoplasty was pseudophakic or aphakic bullous keratoplasty followed by corneal opacity secondary to trauma. The commonest complication in the immediate postoperative period was epithelial defect. The commonest late postoperative complication at the end of 6 months was graft failure followed by secondary glaucoma. Visual acuity preoperatively ranged from PL plus to 6 by 60, and postoperative visual acuity ranged from HNCF to 6 by 12. And 36 patients had visual acuity of more than CF at 1 meter, and 29 patients had visual acuity of more than CF at 3 meters. We found a reduced death to enucleation preservation time was associated with better visual outcome postoperatively. Hospital retrieved corneas were associated with better visual outcome, and also they had a lesser rate of graft failure. In a study done by Manu Thomas et al., where they looked at 30 cases of PK, the corneal opacity was the commonest indication, and the commonest late surgical complication was graft failure, which was very similar to our study. A study done by Anuradha et al., where they looked at 91 eyes of patients who underwent PK, they analyzed the effect of death through enucleation and preservation time and the postoperative visual improvement, and they found a significant result, which was similar to our study. Hospital cornea retrieval program was studied extensively by Dora J. et al., which talks about the need for retrieval from eligible and willing donors in a multidisciplinary setup. It aims at establishing a structure which includes a team that comprises of IVAN technicians, grief counselors, who form the pillars of this missionary. It also involves training the nursing staff about the methods to protect the corneas of the patient who are on end-of-life care, and to educate the relatives of the patient about the importance of prompt eye donation. In our study, we had a strong correlation between hospital-retrieved corneas and the possibility of obtaining a clear graft. This emphasizes the effective hospital corneal retrieval program that exists in our setup and the advantage of a multidisciplinary approach as per the recommendations of HCRP. Conclusion, donor factors such as lesser death to enucleation and hospital donor corneal retrieval are contributory to better visual prognosis. And this study mainly aims to highlight the lesser rates of graft failure associated with hospital retrieved corneas and the need for adequate systems according to the hospital corneal retrieval program to be in place. These are my references. Thank you.
Dr. Praveena, you mentioned about the mode of corneal retrieval, whether it's a whole globe enucleation type or whether it's a corneal button retrieval.
Whole globe enucleation. Whole globe enucleation, sir.
Whole globe enucleation for all cases.
Yes, sir, for all cases.
Okay. Right. So how do you identify the graft failure?
Sir, by the end of 6 months, we followed up on the patient, sir. And whoever patients who had opaque corneas with vascularity and complete loss of vision, we have taken it as graft failure.
Okay. And I believe a single surgeon was involved in this.
Yes, sir. Single.
Same
yes,
surgeon
sir.
For all
yes,
patients.
Yes, sir.
Surgeon's factor. Right.
Yes, sir.
Oh, right. Yeah, or Dr. Chandu. I think you have to unmute, Dr. Chandra.
Yes,
Chandra, you have to unmute.
Yes, sir. Visual acuity, you mentioned is overall HM66, you know, it is just all cases put together. Or have you categorized as pre-operative visual acuity improving to 3 lines, 4 lines? Or is it just all acuity combined together?
So it's all acuity combined together.
So not per the improvement as per the case basis.
Not as per the case.
Yeah. Did you grade all the donor corneas?
Yes, sir.
With any criteria?
Sir, we have taken all very good corneas because we have done only
No. Did you grade them? You know, there is a grading before you do that. And yes, what was the correlation between the grade and your primary graph?
Yes, sir. Clarity wise, but we haven't compared in our study.
You didn't study. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Dr. Praveena, I think it's a very exhaustive study that you've done. Congrats. I have one small question. You said that you compared between the hospital retrieved corneas and corneas retrieved from home, right? So the sample, if you see the number of samples, it's very large. Hospital retrieved, I think, are 46 out of 52, right?
Yes,
among
ma'am.
Your 52.
Yes, ma'am.
So wouldn't
so my
it
data
be?
Is
only- yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Like, do you think it's reliable,
yes, ma'am.
Your conclusion?
Ma'am.
Yeah, that's what I want to say because
yes, ma'am.
You have a much larger number on hospital retrieves,
hospital
right?
Retrieve.
And
yes,
very
ma'am.
Few home corneas. So
yes,
you cannot actually say conclusively that this is better, you know, from your study.
Yes,
right?
ma'am.
If
to continue the study,
yeah. maybe a suggestion, can include, please continue it and have more numbers for both arms. I think then your conclusion will be much better.
Yes,
like,
ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I fully agree with Chandru that grading of donor corneas is a very important element, because that definitely it has got an effect on the outcome. So grading is very important. That's a very important parameter. Thank you.
Wanted to highlight the hospital corneal retrieval program that exists in our setup, sir, mainly. So I would like to continue the study and like get more samples so that I can get equal number
concept
of
concept is good. Concept,
yeah,
is,
concept
very
good. Is good.
Yeah, and what you're trying to convey is also extremely correct. Good only. There's
yes,
no
sir.
Doubt
concept
about
in
it.
The right direction.
Yes, the parameter is very important. Yeah, donor corneal grading is a very important parameter for the outcome.
You can include all the suggestions and continue your study and sure, publish it later.
Correct.
Thank you, sir.
So there are no more questions. We'll go on to the next presenter. I invite Dr. Preeti Shankar to share a screen and go on with the presentation. Dr. Preeti, you have to unmute yourself. Yes.
Good afternoon, respected sir. My paper presentation is on a study based on clinical profile of refractive error among the school-going children in a tertiary care center. Aim of the study was to analyze the clinical profile of refractive error among the school-going children and to study the association with the variables like age, sex, presenting complaints, strabismus, and amblyopia. Here, the inclusion criteria was all those children whose age group was between 6 to 17 years of age, whose parents and guardians gave consent for examination were included in the study. The exclusion criteria, all those uncooperative children on those with dense media opacities and with a history of previous intraocular surgeries were excluded from the study. It was an observational descriptive study of 8 months duration where 445 children's school-going children's of the age group 6 to 17 years were included in the study. These children attended the ophthalmology OPD of the tertiary care center of Dharmapuri district. Previous history, relevant past history and family history was taken from the children. Unaided visual acuity, pinhole vision with Snellen chart was taken. Dry and cycloplegic refraction and autorefractometer refraction was done in these children. Slit lamp examination of the children, detailed fundus examination also was done, and squint evaluation was done, like Hirschberg's test, cover uncover test, and synoptophore test were performed. Results of the study. Of the 445 children included in the study, 58% of the children were more than 12 years of age group, that is 260 children. Of the 445 children, female children were slightly higher numbers, that is 226 children were female, and the male population was 49%. In the presenting complaints, defective vision was a major complaint among these children, followed by headache in 30% children, redness and watering in 14% children, eye strain in 6% of the children, deviation of eyes in 6% of the children, nystagmus and ptosis was present in 1% of the children. Of the 445 children, 64% had a refractive error and the others did not have any refractive error. Of the 284 children with the refractive error, myopia was more common in my study, followed by astigmatism, that is 42%, and hypermetropia 7%. Myopia was 44%, which was more common in my study. In astigmatism, myopic astigmatism was more common. Amblyopia was present in 4% of the children, that is among 11 children, and anisometric amblyopia was more common in this amblyopia, followed by strabismic amblyopia, which was 38%. Strabismus was present in 6% of the children, that is 26 children had a squint presentation with squint, and in this esotropia was more common in the children, followed by exotropia. Esotropia was 58% of the children. Among the 284 children, 48 children were using spectacles previously. That is, only 17% of the children were using spectacles previously. So this study will reinforce the need to evaluate these children's in an early stage and diagnose these children and treat them accordingly. A large number of children were not using any specs in the previously. So lack of awareness and shyness to wear the spectacles may be the cause, as per my study. I want to conclude like this. In other studies, astigmatism was more common in other studies, but in my study, myopia was more common. Thank you. These are my references.
Okay. Doctor, did you look into the family history of these children for the type of refractivity? Did you inquire about the family history for the presence of refractivity? And did you make an attempt? Of course,
yes,
not possible.
Yes, I got the family history. I got the family history, and 63% of the children, parents of the children, had a family history of refractive error.
Okay. Right. Okay. Over to Dr. Chandru.
Yes, sir.
Nothing else, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. I have one question. You're also from the same college where the first paper came from, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So they were doing 11 to 17 years, and you are presenting from 6 to almost first standard to plus 2, isn't it?
Yes, sir. All the children.
But the number you show is much less compared to that that study. Is it the same arm or different study?
It's a different study, sir.
This is a different study, huh?
Yes, sir. Different study, sir.
Different? Period. Different period.
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. You had two teams working for this?
Yes, sir. Two different teams.
Okay. I think this one is a hospital-based study, and that was a community-based study. Right, yes. Dr. Preeti?
Yes, sir. It's done in hospital.
This OPD, is people who visiting the hospital?
Yes.
Hospital
population.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
Hospital
then it is
population.
Good. Okay. So, only thing, you have more myopia than astigmatism compared to the other studies, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So none of these, are these people who have been referred from that particular limb? That's what I would like to know. You would have had cases referred from that, no. Are these people also referred from that particular study, or is it different? That's what I'd like to know.
No, sir. These children were attending the OPD for some or the other ophthalmic complaints, some of the astenopic symptoms.
But they're just walk-in patients.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, the earlier study was more of community screening. I suppose.
Yes,
purely on hospital population.
Yes. Yeah,
right.
Dr. Preeti, could you please stop sharing your screen?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
No, you switch on your video and stop sharing the screen.
So the next presenter would be Dr. Aishwarya. Dr. Aishwarya, please go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Preeti, would like to ask any question for that last person? No.
No, sir.
No, okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I start, sir.
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to present on my free paper topic, Behavior of Meibomian Gland and Tear Film Stability in Various Phases of Menstrual Cycle. The aim of my study was to assess the cyclic change of meibomian gland function and tear film status in females during the pre- and post-menstrual cycle. The materials and methods used were 100 women of fertile age with regular menstrual cycle for a period of 1 year. The tests that were evaluated were Schirmer's 1 and 2 test, the tear breakup time, and the meibomian count was assessed. These patients were analyzed pre- and post-cycle, and the results were evaluated. This slide shows an image of the fluorescent tear breakup time in one of my patients. In our study, the subjects were divided into three groups as 15 to 25, 26 to 35, and 36 to 49 years, according to the fertile age group of women. Okay, so we analyzed the Schirmer's and the T-bit of these fertile women in the premenstrual and the postmenstrual cycle, which is also referred to as the follicular and the luteal phase. In the age group between the 15 to 25 years, the average Schirmer's was found to be 32 and 30 millimeters in the pre- and postmenstrual cycle, respectively. Whereas in the 26 and 35 years, it was 30 and 26. And in the group of 36 to 49 years, the Schirmer's was 26 and 22 millimeter in the pre- and postmenstrual phase, respectively. Therefore, we can see that there is a reduction in the Schirmer's test in the postmenstrual cycle. Next, we assessed the tear breakup time and found that there was a reduction of 2 to 3 seconds in the postmenstrual cycle in all age groups. In this graph, the pink bar shows a decline in the Schirmer's in the postmenstrual cycle, as well as a decline in the T-bud as shown by the pink line. This slide shows an image of the meibomian gland from one of my patients. Additionally, we calculated the meibomian gland count of these 100 fertile women, and it was estimated to be 62, 54, and 52, according to the age groups between 15 to 25, 26 to 35, and 36 to 49 years, respectively. So here, as the age increases, there is a decrease in the meibomian gland count owing to the atrophy of the glands, and this can be due to the reduced hormonal levels in elderly females. So the results were analyzed as follows. Although the meibomian gland count is adequate, there is a reduction in the Schirmer's and the T-bud in the luteal phase of the normal menstrual cycle. This could be due to increased estrogen and progesterone in the luteal phase, where the meibomian gland orifice becomes smaller and the volume of the meibomian gland reduces. This shows that women during this phase are more prone for infection. I would like to conclude by saying that the findings of my study show that the meibomian gland exhibit a cyclic change in the menstrual cycle. The physiology of the meibomian gland during postmenstrual may influence on the tear film stability, resulting in an evaporative type of dry eye. My take-home message is that females with long-term continuous use of computer devices and with screen display during this phase may further aggravate, causing a decrease in the number of the blinks, leading to incomplete blinks, evaporation of tears, and thereby dry eye disease. So any tear film abnormalities during this phase could be prevented by adopting precautionary measures like staying hydrated and avoiding heat tents. Thank you.
Doctor, that's a nice presentation.
Thank you.
The slide presentation is quite good, impressive. I just want to know how you assessed the meibomian gland count.
Can you stop your share, slide share?
Yes, sir.
I had the same question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I assessed with the help of automated refractometer, sir.
Oh.
With the use of automated refractometer, I averted the lids of the patient and I could trace the meibomian gland striation, sir.
Is it accurate?
Okay. No, ma'am. It is not accurate. We didn't have meibography and confocal microscopy.
Yes.
So with the setup which was available to me, I just used the automated refractometer, sir.
There's only recently that Lippi view, I think, is available in the market. So I was wondering how you would assess the
Lippi scan.
Platform. Mm-hmm. Lippi scan, yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, okay. Right. Okay. Over to Dr. Chandru.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now, all these 100 people you have taken, no?
Yes, sir.
They were otherwise normal people or people with complaints?
With normal people, sir. Normal
you just,
females.
You just picked up normal people from your hospital.
Yes, sir.
And then tested them.
Yes, sir.
Did any of them have any symptoms of dry eye post-period?
No, sir. They didn't have any complaints of dry eye. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Aishwarya.
Yes, ma'am.
Very neat slides.
Thank you, ma'am.
But you said that all the parameters, especially the Shirmas and T-Butt, came down after the menstrual cycle, right?
Yes, yes.
But was there any statistical significance between that and this? Or you just gone by the numbers?
I just went by the numbers, ma'am. Okay. Just by the numbers, the average data I took. And I'm working on another study also, ma'am. So after that, I'll with the part two, I can just statistically evaluate, ma'am.
Yeah, because ideally to say that there was a difference, you should have done some statistical tests.
Yes,
you know, just the numbers will not be able to reflect the actual truth. So yeah, statistical tests would have been better.
Yes,
anyway,
ma'am.
You please continue that.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, with that, we'll go on to the next presenter, Dr. Debolina Deb. Please go ahead with your presentation.
Respected judges,
Deborah, you're not very audible. Could you please increase your volume?
You can hear me now?
Yes, but it's very feeble.
Okay, sir, am I audible now?
Yes.
Yes.
Please share your screen.
Yes, sir. So is my screen usable?
No, it's visible.
Just coming up.
So is the screen visible now?
Not yet.
But the presentation is not seen. I think it's just you have started screen sharing.
Yes, sir. It's showing on my screen, sir.
No, it is not yet come.
Here,
you stop share and share again.
Yes.
You share your PowerPoint window only.
You stop sharing and then reshare again.
Yes, sir.
Numerotic, Sai or somebody, can you stop the screen share of Debolina? You can stop the screen share and again she can start sharing. Or whoever is the administrator.
Yes, sir. We'll let them know, sir.
Yeah. Even you can do, I think. Because if you're a co-host, you can do that.
I'm not the co-host, so I will not be able to do that. I'm just calling him, sir.
Okay. You're not able to stop share. I think the connection is very poor.
Yes, I think the connection is not.
Can we do the next paper and then come back to this, sir?
That would be better, sir. We can do
better,
the next presentation and come back to this.
Yes, sir. Yes.
I will go. Next paper.
Okay. Vaidyanathan is the next presenter.
Yeah.
Please.
Good afternoon to all. At the outset, I would like to thank TNF for the opportunity given to me amidst the postgraduates who are presenting. I'm a practitioner for 23 years and I think I'm an odd one out in this group. Anyway, I would go ahead with my presentation. Congratulations to TNOE and Madras ICON for the wonderful virtual meeting that they have arranged for the sake of postgraduates. And new pterygium surgery and expiring technique for best cosmesis and least recurrence. That's my paper today. Pterygium, as you all know, is very common. It can be small atrophic or a large aggressive one. And the parts include head, neck, body, cap. Today, the focus would be on the neck, which is the portion over the limbal area with the two wings on either side. And the surgeon, that's me, has been doing wing sparing technique on expiring procedure for a long time. And I decided to see the result in terms of recurrence rate and cosmesis in the last 2 years. with at least 6 months follow-up. Following pterygium surgeries, recurrence is the biggest challenge, and conjunctival autograft with fibrin glue has been proven to have the least recurrence by many studies. Here we are describing a new technique called the wing sparing technique, which seemed to have no recurrence. So we retrospectively analyzed 129 pterygium patients operated from 2018 to 2019, and age of the patients ranged from 25 to 76 years. Numbers were of female and male were equal, almost, and double pterygium recurrent cases and cases lost to follow-up were recurrent pterygium operated, and cases were lost to follow-up were excluded from the study. And in our study, inferior infratemporal sites were chosen for graft in order to spare the superior bulbar conjunctiva for future trabeculectomy if need arises. Tisil glue was used in all cases. Earlier, we used to use Relisil, but then we shifted to Tisil. In the study, all were Tisil. So this is a case where though the pterygium looks like a atrophic pterygium, the cylinder, induced cylinder was 3 diopters, and it is also correlating with the picture, the topographic picture. This is a case of chronic scleritis patient, so slightly congested eye, and that's the video I'm showing today here. But the surgical technique is the same in all cases. Xylocaine was used subconjunctivally, and the head is separated, and wings are spared, wings are not cut at all. So if you see the some calcified material that was separated, and then a triangular body with the apex facing towards canthus is removed. So altogether a diamond shaped tissue is excised. And correlating with the...
One minute more.
Yeah, so the inferior conjunctiva is used for the graft, sorry. It is important that subconjunctival tissue is separated well, and limbus is cut last, limbal area is cut last, and then glue is used on both sides, and the donor site also is closed with the glue, so that donor site granuloma is prevented. So subconjunctival hemorrhage was the commonest excellent cosmesis. Sunlight, we found that in our study, 20% salt workers, 30% fishermen, many had exposure to sunlight. And bas, sclera, conjunctiva, all these were present. Wide excisions had been mentioned, and amniotic membranes are also, have earlier been described, MMC, beta irradiation, all that were lost. Our technique is different, that we are doing the wing sparing technique, inferior or infratemporal autograft with no recurrence. In any of the cases. So the superior bulbar is spared for future trabeculectomy. So here, if you see just quickly, again, the same I'm showing. So diamond-shaped tissue cut, the wings are spared, and the graft is taken from the inferotemporal site, and conjunctiva has been well separated from the tenons when you take the graft. Yeah, thank you. These are my references.
Thanks for the nice video, Dr. Valija. It's quite interesting. What do you think is the mechanism? I mean, in what way it is better than other techniques? What's the mechanism support?
Yeah, probably the wings on either side, that's where a gush of growth happens usually in recurrence after a conjunctival autograft. So since we are sparing the wings, it is acting as a barrier for the tissue, the recurrence to come, I feel.
Okay, and
Your
follow-up has been maximum 6 months, isn't it?
Up to 2 years. Some of the cases up to 2 years. Oh. Minimum 6 months.
Minimum 6 months.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Over to Dr. Chandru.
Yeah,
Thank you, Dr. Vanuja. Okay. So is this your own technique or are there any references regarding this elsewhere?
Yeah, I saw one of the international speakers mentioning about sparing the wings, but I tried looking for reference, but I couldn't get that reference at all. That's how I started about 3-4 years back itself, this technique, and last 2 years study only I've shown you.
The minimum follow-up is probably 4 months or something.
Yeah.
Because March you would have submitted the paper. November November you registered.
Till December.
December and March you would have submitted the paper.
Yeah.
Correct.
March,
okay.
No.
Yeah, yeah. Minimum, you know, recurrence occurs how early in your study?
Till June, the follow-up is there. Till June also.
It is not there in the original.
When I gave the write-up, it is minimum.
In the synopsis, it is not there. Okay. Thank you.
Very nice study, ma'am. Congratulations. Mm-hmm. Only one question, ma'am. You said the recurrence is, it's better than other methods. But to say that you should have ideally done a comparison between the regular autograft and this, to say that this is better, even that may have, in your hands,
very
that
true.
Also may not have recurrence. That's the only point.
No, very true. Earlier, I was doing the wide excision, cutting out the wings. I did have many recurrences. But after I started this technique, I was not getting recurrence at all. That's the reason I did the study to see whether I had.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, Dr. Vanuja, can we go ahead with your presentation?
Second yeah. Presentation. Okay.
And after you are finished, I think Dr. Debolina can present.
Yeah. Setting up dry eye clinic, the need of the hour. So that's my paper, and dry eye can be mainly aqueous deficient or evaporative dry eye, and in this digital era it's mainly evaporative dry eye due to MGD. In IOPD we see many symptoms related to dry eye, but many times we just symptomatically treat them and without looking at the actual cause. So we wanted to assess the magnitude and type of dry eyes in our general OPD, the need for dedicated dry eye clinic. So instead of the OSDI and the speed questionnaires, we decided to formulate a small question of our own with symptoms yes or no, and computer user whether yes or no, and whether patient had cataract surgery, refractive or any other surgery using contact lens, glaucoma drops, etc. And this is the questionnaire, and patients were just asked to tick yes or no. And any SS where these patients were taken up for cataract workup, dry eye workup. So dry eye, even cataract patients were also, all the cataract evaluated patients were also subjected to dry eye workup. Slit lamp examination, meibomianitis grading, T-BUT, Schirmer's test, Lippi scan, all these were done in these patients. And out of the 2,200 patients, 286 patients were chosen of dry eye workup with positivity in this from this questionnaire. So 30% of general OPD roughly had symptoms of dry eye and were in these categories. And of these, when we did Schirmer's test, less than 20 millimeter at 5 minutes was taken as positive, and T-BUT less than 10 seconds was taken as positive. And more than 30% dropout of meibomian glands were taken as moderate MGD and counseled for Lippi flow. And Lippi flow for patients who underwent Lippi flow, we did OSDI and speed questionnaire. And at 1 to 2 months follow-up also, the same questionnaire was repeated to see the improvement post Lippi flow. And at 1 month and 3 months, other tests, Schirmer's, T-BUT also were done. So these are the things we followed in Lippi flow patients, speed questionnaire and T-BUT. And this is the chart which we followed, flow chart we followed. Reduced T-BUT, moderate cases, Lippi flow. Severe cases under guarded prognosis, Lippi flow. Sorry. Schirmer's reduced cases, mild to moderate cases, conservative treatment, severe cases, punctal occlusion. Mixed cases, we had to do mixed management. So out of the 786 patients who underwent dry eye workup, 31 had lowered Schirmer's, 79 had lowered T-BUT, 10% had both values lowered, and 10% had normal values. 90% of patients have more than 30% dropout in lipid scan. So that's the importance of doing dry eye workup in all the high-risk category patients. Of the 90 patients who underwent lipid flow, all of them had improvement in symptoms, OSDI, speed scores, and T-BUT values at 6 weeks. So I just skip the discussion. So just
1 minute more.
It is important that we stress on patients blinking, because reduced blink rate is thought to be the cause for MGD, and also other precipitating factors, air conditioner, then lack of sleep, insufficient water intake, and omega-3 fatty acids, smoking, contact lens usage, glaucoma management, and post-refractive. All these are important, and preventive care is important. OSDI and speed questionnaires were very elaborate and so time and also time-consuming. So we used this simpler version in our patients to screen. And patients were chosen for lipid flow or punctal cautery or flux, depending on the severity. The severe cases were easily analyzed. And preventive care could be given to the milder cases. So high incidence of evaporative dry eye due to MGD mandates creation of awareness and need for setting up a dedicated dry eye clinic to diagnose and treat appropriately and thereby improve quality of sight, work, and of life in patients, also to prevent sight-threatening complications. These are my references, and thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vanaja, for interesting and very informative because dry eye has become a very hot topic now. The conduct of all the online classes
is a much talked
about topic everywhere. We hear parents complaining about the
digital eye problems.
Yes, very much in the new hot news now. It's very difficult to assess a senior ophthalmologist like you against a multitude of novices.
Yeah.
It's a very difficult predicament for the judges. But anyway, thanks for the informative paper. Thank you.
I think I would not be a candidate as standing with the postgraduates. You can exclude me from judging with them, I suppose.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Vanaja. I think this is more useful, and people will get to know the importance. Definitely.
And lipid flow, in this study, I've shown 90 numbers, but we are up to nearing 200, and we are going to publish the results soon. It is a very important study we are doing.
Definitely a new look, to treat it in a better way. Thank you.
Ma'am, just again one comment, ma'am. The new questionnaire that you developed, you told that you developed your own questionnaire. So... Yes. I suggest that you can actually, if you standardized it, you can copyright the questionnaire, that it will be useful for others also. If it's more simpler to use, you can copyright it and give it for public domain so others in their studies can also use the questionnaire.
Sure.
I think she can validate this questionnaire over a period of time.
Standardized,
validate, and then definitely she can post it in the public domain.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So, Dr. Debelina, I think you can go ahead. I hope your presentation is online.
Is it visible now, sir?
Yes, go ahead. It's clear.
Voice is also audible?
Yes. Please go ahead.
Come to the introduction. Glaucoma is defined as a chronic progressive optic neuropathy caused by a group of ocular conditions leading to damage of the optic nerve with loss of visual function. The most common known risk factor is increased IOP. Over here, I'll be talking more about the translaminar fibrosa pressure difference, which is the difference between the intraocular pressure and the CSF pressure. The lamina fibrosa is presumed to be the site for the glaucomatous optic neuropathy due to pressure of intraocular and the retrolamina compartment. In my study, it's a prospective observational study on 94 patients conducted over 2 years. we studied 47 patients as cases who were diagnosed with glaucoma in both eyes and 47 patients as controls without glaucoma. We took patients above the age of 20 years with untreated primary open angle and primary angle closure glaucoma and excluded patients who had neurological disorders or any conditions obscuring the view of the fundus and patients with secondary glaucoma. For each patient, we noted down the age, the BMI, blood pressure, pulse pressure, diastolic blood pressure. A complete ophthalmic examination was conducted for each patient. Pachymetry, intraocular pressure, keratometry, and axial length was noted. Based on the pilot study by Zee et al., they devised a formula to measure the CSF pressure, which depended on the BMI, diastolic blood pressure, and the age. And also, we checked the ocular perfusion pressure. The following is the given normal range for these pressure. So basically, we found out the association of CSF pressure, translaminar fibrosa pressure difference, intraocular pressure, and ocular perfusion pressure between the cases and controls, and the subgroups of primary open angle and angle closure glaucoma, open angle and controls, and angle closure and controls. Out of all my patients, 52 patients were female, 42 patients were male. Mean age was 54.3 years, mean BMI was 24.83, and mean IOP was 17. And on comparing the glaucoma and the control group, we saw that the diastolic blood pressure, pulse pressure, intraocular pressure, the central corneal thickness, and the translaminar fibrosa pressure difference was significantly greater in the glaucoma group, and axial length was significantly lesser than the control group. This is a table showing the same and the graph. On comparing the primary open angle and angle closure glaucoma, we had 74.5% having open angle and 25.5% having angle closure. On comparing the pressure parameters, none of them had statistical significance. Comparing open angle and the control groups, we saw that the translaminar fibrosa pressure difference and intraocular pressure had a statistical significance and higher in open angle cases. Similarly, in the angle closure cases and control, we saw that the translaminar fibrosa pressure difference and intraocular pressure were statistically significant and higher in the angle closure group than controls. So coming to the discussion, the mean age of a study population was 54.3 years, which is similar to the Central India Eye Study. And in our study, we saw that the glaucomatous eyes had a lower CSF pressure than the non-glaucomatous eyes, which is similar to the Burdall et al. Study. In our study, the diastolic blood pressure was also significantly higher in the glaucoma patients and controls. The mean intraocular pressure as well was higher, similar to the Beijing Eye Study. Along with that, also the mean translaminar fibrosa pressure difference was also significantly higher, which is again similar to the Beijing Eye Study. Hence, we may infer that the translaminar fibrosa pressure difference and intraocular pressure play a role in the pathophysiology of the glaucomatous optic neuropathy and all glaucomatous.
One
minute
more.
Ocular perfusion pressure was not very significant in any of the groups, but it was lower when it was seen. I'll just skip a few slides and come to the main point over here. We were seeing the intraocular pressure difference between the angle closure glaucoma group and the non-glaucoma group, and it was more pronounced between the difference between open angle and non-glaucoma group, which is similar to Central India Eye Study. But and also the CSF pressure difference between the angle closure and control group was greater than the open angle. But this is contradictory to the Central India Eye group. This is possibly because of the smaller sample size we had in a study. To come to a conclusion, we can say that we can also, along with intraocular pressure, diastolic blood pressure, pulse pressure and translaminar fibrosa pressure can be measured to determine the patients at risk of developing glaucoma and advise them for an early glaucoma screening. Thank you.
Doctor, since it's a very exhaustive study,
yes, sir.
It's a very big topic, I agree. And you showed us one formula to calculate the CSF pressure.
Yes,
theoretically. So I don't know whether it's so reliable as the actual measurement of CSF pressure.
Yes, sir. Actually,
I'm not conversant with it. I would like to know.
Actually, that that measurement was devised by in the China by the Beijing Eye Study. Zee et al. Had done it. So they compared it with the CSF pressure while they were comparing with patients who they were undergoing lumbar puncture. So then they standardized it for their study also. Along with that, in India, Central India Eye Study also, medical study also used the same formula. And they also got similar results to it, sir.
And you could have made the slides even a little concise. It was too crowded, I feel. I'm sorry to comment on that, but still, I need to tell you. There were too much of material on the slide. It's very difficult to follow in a very short. Okay, anyway, it's a good research paper. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Over to Dr. Chandru.
Yes, sir. You are in a medical college.
Yes, sir, I just finished my post-graduation.
So basically, you know, the slide should tell us what you want to tell by reading. We should understand. You know, by when you go on skipping slides and going here, you know, by the time we see it is over. But overall, it is a good attempt on a procedure and you know, combination of various formulas to analyze. It is okay, but we need to see the actual outcomes with the even bigger numbers and correlation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Rivolin, I agree with both the senior persons that what they said. I think the problem is you have too much of information. So it's difficult to convey that in 4 minutes. You should have attempted to make it more, you know, this is not more than 6 lines per slide and all that. I underwent your paper. So, but the presentation you could have concised. But otherwise, it's a very innovative thing. I think not many studies have been done on translaminar cribrosa pressure. So that way, it's a very good attempt. Have you published it already? Or One more thing is that you got many differences. There is a difference, but you say that it's not statistically significant, right? Yeah. So that means you need more sample size and redo the same tests again. So you may get a statistical significance because of... This could be because of your small sample size. So probably if you continue it and, you know, you may get a statistical significance. That will be more meaningful, right?
Okay.
Yeah, but a very good attempt, I would say.
Thank you, ma'am.
Sir, if they have done, can all the presenters leave, sir?
All the presenters.
Oh, thank you so much. All of you did a good job.
Yeah.
All the best to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You can all leave now. All the presenters.
Thank you, chairpersons and moderator. Thank you.
Welcome.
Dr.
Kumaran. Yes, sir.
So we need to submit, isn't it? Finally.
Sir, 1 minute, sir. After they go. Everybody is left. Huh? No, Vanuja has to leave.
Okay.
Niranjana, Kavya.
Yes.
Two more.
Kavya has not left.
You can also take them out.
So I'm not there. Dr. Niranjan, could you just ask Kavya to end the meet?
Niranjan is okay.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Niranjan, yes. Niranjan.